Our passage this morning is Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. Because this morning, it's Christmas Eve, and we want to look at the birth of Jesus. And all of these passages during our season of Advent, they've been so familiar, haven't they? They've been passages that almost seem to have been burned into our cerebral cortex. Like, we know these passages so very well. But that can be detrimental to sitting before God's Word, listening to God's Word, and trusting the Holy Spirit to teach us something in a story that we hadn't seen before. And probably more importantly than all of that is to actually correct ways we've misunderstood this familiar passage. So what we'll be looking at this morning is the passage of the actual birth of Jesus. And I would appeal to you, as Julie did this morning, would you please consider coming back at 4 p.m. for our service of lessons and carols? It's a very short service, 1 hour. We listen to God's word being read by our elders and our deacons, and we sing together. And we do that back and forth 9 times. It's in church history known as a service of 9 lessons. But that happens this evening. And the scene that we're looking at this morning is a scene about the birth of Jesus. And immediately following this is the scene with the shepherds. And when we come back at 4 p.m., I want to say a few words about Luke chapter 2, verses 8 onward, the scene of the shepherds. But for this morning, let's just look at 2 verses 1 through 7. Very simple passage about the birth of our Lord and Savior. So I'm going to ask if you would listen again to God's word, and I'll open our time in prayer. This is from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who is with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. This is the word of our Lord. Would you join me in prayer? Our Father, thank you for speaking to us, for making yourself known. We ask that you would knock away the crustiness of our former understanding of this passage if we have misunderstood what you are teaching us here. Holy Spirit, would you kindly and gently do that to us? Thank you for this time. Amen. There's a passage from 1 Corinthians. And we looked at 1 Corinthians weeks and weeks ago. But there's a passage in which Paul is addressing these believers in this church. And he says, not many of you are wise by worldly standards, or powerful, or noble by birth. And in some ways, when Paul opens a letter like that, he's calling us out for our weaknesses. It may very well be that in the church in Corinth, there were some that were very wise, of course, by the world standards. There may have even been some in the church who were of nobility. They could trace a noble line somehow. But really what Paul is saying there in 1 Corinthians 1, verse 26, is he's saying that, aren't we all common? Aren't we all common? Thank you for being here at King's Cross, the fourth Sunday in Advent. You're all just common, and I'm common. Thank you for being here. But Jesus actually works through that which is common. And that's what's happening in the passage that you've just heard. You've heard a passage in which an unknown man and an unknown woman are actually being compelled, pushed to go someplace else. And they actually do go someplace else. Why? Because they're just common people. They're just following the rules. We're common people. And yet, the King of the cosmos has come to be with us. He's come to be with you. That's what we're discovering in this passage. We so celebrate, don't we, when a celebrity becomes a Christian. All the Christians are watching TV and high-fiving because they know that man or that woman who has all this fame and all this money, they just professed faith in Jesus, and Christians are so happy. You should be happy. But that Jesus would actually take someone who is an absolute and total nobody and adopt them into a royal family with all of the privileges that comes with. That Jesus would do that, well, isn't that more exciting than your favorite celebrity being converted? And this is just how Jesus works. And when we look in this passage, I want us to understand from this passage that God is willing to work through the ordinary. Doesn't that sound simple enough? God is willing to work through the ordinary. And the ordinary for Joseph and Mary in this passage, you can see twofold. It's an ordinariness in which they're being pushed around, manipulated by politics and politicians. That's how ordinary this passage is. They're being manipulated and pushed around, even perhaps politically captive. But they're also ordinary in another way. Verses 1 through 5, it's all about that political captivity. But verses 6 through 7, it's a different kind of commonness that Joseph and Mary have to suffer under. And that's not a political captivity. That's more something like a social decay. The world in which they live is somehow a broken world. And that, too, is ordinary. I want to argue in this passage that all of us know exactly what this is like. All of us know what it's like to be common by political standards and common by social standards, to feel as though we don't have very much control over our lives because there are very important people in Washington, D.C. making decisions for us. Or we feel like we don't have very much power over our lives because we have neighbors that are just not very neighborly. Because neighborliness is a little hard to find nowadays. Really what our job is to keep ourselves safe and protected from political leaders, but kind of safe and protected from neighbors. We're common. And Joseph and Mary are common. And yet, Jesus comes. Let me tell you what I mean by this political captivity in the first five verses. You read verses 1 through 5 and you see a lot of proper nouns, long names that are hard to pronounce, and it feels a little bit, doesn't it, like a historical biography of sorts, just a bunch of data, details. Caesar is there. We got a governor, Quirinius, never heard of this guy. Something about an official decree. Doesn't it sound official? And Luke is doing this to show how Joseph and Mary have no choice but to succumb to political captivity. I mean, really, this is about money. I think that's fair to say. You don't have to be a historian of the classics to see this. Registration, Luke mentions three times in these verses. Do you see that? Verse 1, verse 2, verse 3. No, he does another time, doesn't he? It's there also in verse 5. So four times he mentions registration. And that word from registration has the word graph in it. To be registered is to be put on someone else's graph. You want that? To be a part of someone else's statistical research? But that's really what this means. And we know why. It's because Rome wants to count money. That's why. You know, Egypt, of all the nations of the ancient world, Egypt did the best job of counting people. And they counted people every 14 years, and they did so because they wanted to know how much money to expect, right? You got a budget, but you also need to find those rascals who aren't paying. But you also need to do a census in order for military preparedness. You need to know how many soldiers you have access to if you go to war. But in Rome, Rome didn't seem to run a census on a regular basis, but it's happening now. And Jews, by the way, were exempt from military service. So it's not about looking for soldiers, or not likely so. It's about counting heads so you can count dollars. It's about GDP. It's about finding out how much wealth Rome has. And in many ways, isn't this like assuming that people are property? And it is like that. It's exactly like that, as we'll see. But what it is right now is it's Joseph and Mary having to do something so that they can be counted and put on a graph so that people in Rome whom they've never met nor ever will meet can tabulate their own wealth. And by the way, it's not a small inconvenience. It's a 70-mile inconvenience. I mean, Joseph and Mary, actually, Mary doesn't have to. Only Joseph has to. But Joseph has got to find a way to travel 70 miles to Bethlehem. By the way, there's no scriptural evidence that Joseph has ever been to Bethlehem. Incidentally, there's no scriptural evidence that Jesus returns to Bethlehem. King David was born in Bethlehem. There's no biblical evidence that King David ever went back to Bethlehem. Isn't that interesting? And yet, he's got to be counted so that someone can measure their own wealth. And he has to travel 70 miles, 2 days, maybe 3 days, because Joseph brings his wife. He brings his wife, and she's pregnant. And we know that in the narrative. And when he gets to Bethlehem, he can expect very few connections because he just doesn't know the city. Just think for a moment, again, kind of knocking out some of your presuppositions about this passage. Just think for a moment about how inconvenient this is for such foolish purposes. No one here likes paying taxes. And in fact, our dislike of paying taxes usually enfolds itself into our voting preferences. So we're going to vote for this guy because he's not likely to raise our taxes, and we're not going to vote for this person because they're likely to do so. None of us like taxes. April is just kind of a sad month, isn't it? And a lot of decisions that you make throughout the year, you need to make those decisions with the middle of April in mind. It's just the way life is. And we come together and we complain about it. We're unhappy about it. But we do it anyway. You know, there's a population of America that is slowly dying. And this population knows a kind of inconvenience that's that times a million. And during the time of World War II, 1942 in particular, taxes, of course, go up because the government needs more money. So it's not so much that taxes go up, but more people are enfolded into paying taxes in 1942. And a rationing system is started so that everyone is issued a certain amount of points. Some things you simply couldn't purchase. I think tires were very hard to purchase. Gasoline was actually really hard to purchase as well. Bicycles were hard to purchase. So factories need to be used for the war effort. So normal purchases, not only were they edited down because you have X number of ration points, but some things you're just not going to be able to get a hold of. And this impacts your parenting. This impacts your marriage. This impacts how you grow up. This impacts your view on life. That's inconvenient. Now, the purpose there is grand, isn't it? The purpose is we are fighting a war. But Joseph and Mary's life is, they're almost like marionettes. They're being played by members of the world who live far, far away from them. And it is inconvenient, and it's painful. It's something to keep in mind before I move on. God doesn't make that go away before Jesus comes. God doesn't make that go away before Jesus comes. The one who is holding God's own Son, conceived by the Holy Spirit, is attached to strings and is a big puppet master in Rome who's running those strings, making decisions that have implications for their entire earthly life. And God doesn't cut the strings. He just comes. It's not just money either. Did you notice in the beginning of this passage, the word world is there? And then in a verse after that, all people. Luke, as he tells the story, he's saying this was a dramatic thing. Everyone was involved. Now, when he says the whole world, Rome doesn't own the whole world. But Luke is telling us that it's not only about money, this political captivity. It's about a more personal kind of captivity. It's an ownership thing. You know, incidentally, when Taylor read our passage this morning, the passage I'm not preaching from, Luke chapter 1, in verse 5, that passage is about the birth of John the Baptist. And when John the Baptist was born, this guy named Herod gets involved, right? Herod is mentioned in Luke 1, verse 5. But the scale for Jesus is actually larger. Herod is a local ruler. Now, are you kidding me? We got Caesar Augustus involved, and he's charging what seems to be the entire world, that this world would be counted by him. He's more than flexing his muscles. The word that Luke uses for the Caesar is Caesar Augustus. And that name, Augustus, really is not a name. The leader in Rome was born Octavian, but he received the title Augustus, and Luke uses the title Augustus. What does Augustus mean? Divine Savior is what Augustus means. Joseph and Mary, they're being counted for their money or the potential money that they'll make, but they're also being owned. They're being owned by the powers of the world. That's how much of a nobody Joseph is and a nobody Mary is. And this registration, it's a reminder that they're owned by someone else. It's Rome putting them under its thumb and saying, don't forget, you are a conquered people. And again, none of this stops God. None of this stops God. He enters a political system without fixing it first. He enters a system in which they are being taxed, they're being treated like a commodity, and he enters a system in which they are being received as having been owned by someone else. And it's almost as if God doesn't bat an eye. He comes. He doesn't care about that circumstance. He waltzes right into time and space without hesitating, and he's there. There's a great application for this at the end of the sermon, but a hint is, do you want to have a God like that? Your circumstances don't interrupt this God. More on that later. God enters a world of political captivity, verses 1 through 5, but he also enters a world of social decay, verses 6 through 7. Political captivity, social decay. How common are Joseph and Mary? Well, when they arrive in Bethlehem, the very moment they arrive, they need help. They just do. They need help. And when you look in this passage, you see in verse 6 that while they were there, that's what Luke says, while they were there. Just notice that expression in verse 6, while they were there. And the way this is communicated in the Greek, the focus or the emphasis on while they were there is delay, is a delay of time. While they were there, there's problems. They don't have immediate help. They're looking. And they're most likely not looking for one day. Don't we always think that when they stroll into Bethlehem, Jesus is born on that very day? But Luke is more ambiguous than that. Luke doesn't say Jesus was born the same day. Luke, in fact, seems to stretch out the time. They were in Bethlehem for a while, looking for help while they were there. They're searching. They're waiting. Perhaps there's someone that will help. Mary, by the way, looks like a pregnant woman. It's noticeable. And they're waiting, and they're wandering, and they're looking. A couple of days ago, a neighbor came over. Karen and I are from Tennessee, And actually, both Karen and I are pretty chit-chatty anyway, but we noticed, even just visiting Ashburn, that when we were standing in line at a grocery store, we're always, like, chit-chatty. But Ashburn's not a really chit-chatty place. Like if you feel that it is, maybe you haven't been to Chattanooga, Tennessee. So Karen and I have just kind of noticed that, you know, we tend to be the chit-chatty ones. So for Christmas, my lovely wife, she goes to all of our neighbors and she's giving out cookies. So I'm chit-chatty, but that's maybe a level above me. I'm not with her, but she's doing that. But sometimes when she does that, we get strange visitors. And a couple of days ago, we had a strange visitor, a lady who had received one of Karen's boxes of cookies. And she came to our doorstep, and she had something. She's from Poland, so it was something that was unfamiliar to me. Me and unfamiliar foods have an interesting relationship. But she stood there with this, and Karen and I were just shocked. We're just surprised. And she said, "You gave me a gift, I'm giving you this," with a very thick accent. I had never seen her before. We live in a townhouse. People seem to just kind of walk in and never come out unless they're going to their car. But this lady who came over hugged Karen, hugged her, like in Ashburn, like a hug, like an unashamed hug. We never met this person before, and it was beautiful. It was lovely. And so the food was wonderful. The gift was wonderful. The gesture was wonderful. But the hug was amazing. And that's what we talked about. Why were we like that? We're from Chattanooga. Chattanoogans hug all the time. Because neighborliness is kind of hard, isn't it? It's rare. You don't find it all the time. And Joseph and Mary are in a city in the ancient world. And don't we always think that people used to be neighborly? They used to be neighborly 10 years ago, 2 decades, 3 decades. But in the ancient world, they certainly were neighborly, right? Everything's better in the past. That's how I tend to think. But Joseph and Mary, no neighbor. No neighbor. No neighbor. And for a while, they're looking for a place. No Holy Spirit, by the way, jumping into a person and giving them super spiritual neighborly gifts. God just lets it roll out. Joseph and Mary wandering in Bethlehem. And we're told in verse 7 that there was no place for them. But when you look at the beginning of verse 6 and the end of verse 7, would you please consider that that's more than just a day or two or three? Beginning of verse 6, end of verse 7. While they were there, there was no place for them. And it could be they're on a waiting list. It could be they're trying most houses, but they haven't tried every house. It could be that the neighbors are now talking about them. You know, who's the strange guy and the pregnant woman wandering around? We just don't know what's happening, but we know it's common. Couldn't be more boring. And yet God allows them to do that, and God still comes. The surprise seems to happen. You see that in verse 6. The time came for her to give birth. Childbirth is like that. It's expected but unexpected at the same time. It's how childbirth works. Expected and unexpected. And the time came. But when Luke says the time came, it's God who's in the driver's seat. He says something that's almost literally translated as the fullness of time came. And God's ready. And the time came for her to give birth. And if we need any indication of just how common this was, just consider the things that we are told about Mary. Mary, she wraps the baby in swaddling cloths. You see that? Long strips of fabric. Very simple. And by the way, to see a baby in swaddling cloths, I mean, this is going to be a sign for shepherds. Come back at 4 p.m., you'll hear that. It's going to be a sign for shepherds, the baby in swaddling cloths. Yeah, big deal. Babies are in swaddling cloths. But you know what's interesting about this? Who wraps baby Jesus in the swaddling cloths in our passage? It's Mary who does that. She's probably got other things on her mind, doesn't she? She's just done something. She's given birth. And at least one commentator calls this out and says, we should hear in that Mary's alone. She's alone. It's not like all the neighbors, when they hear a screaming baby, they come rushing to her attention and say, oh, you're having the baby that soon. Had I known that, I would have loaned you a bed. And now I'll help you and I'll wrap your baby up for you. No, Mary's doing that because she's alone. God comes to her in her loneliness. And the baby is placed on a manger. A manger is exactly what you've heard that it is. A manger is a place animals go to get food. That's what it's an animal's dinner plate. That's where the baby goes. She's so uncared for that that's the only place she has for a baby. There wasn't a single neighbor that said, you know what, I have the last bed in town, but I'll sleep on the ground so that you can sleep in the bed for a couple of days in case that baby comes. That doesn't happen. The only place they have is the place where the animals eat and the animals drool. I'm not highlighting this so that we can complain about God, that God didn't humble Rome before Jesus entered the world. And that God, he didn't increase the neighborliness of the city of Bethlehem before he came. This isn't a sermon that says that, boy, God is just not caring for the details and he's holding back his power and making people suffer needlessly. That's not the point. This is the point. He's willing to work through the ordinary. That's the point. And I think there's two applications here. The first one is this. By the way, this is, I'll tie these things together here. God is willing to work through the ordinary. The first application is this. Could all of us agree to try and catch ourselves when we try to write God into our screenplay rather than being written into his screenplay? It's a funny expression, isn't it? Can we catch ourselves before we write God into our screenplay when really it's we who have been written into his screenplay? Nick Hornby wrote a novel called About a Boy, and it's about a very selfish man, and this man's trying to live his life without being touched by others, and he says this. He says that a person's life is like a TV show, and I'm the star of the Will show. His name's Will. A person's life is like a TV show, and I'm the star of the Will show. And the Will show wasn't an ensemble drama. Guests came and they went, but I was the regular. Isn't that great? I'm the regular. Me, myself, and I. That's it. And the guests, they just come and go. And really, you have a responsibility to live your show. And I'll live my show. And if your ratings tank and things don't go well with your show, or you invite some guest characters that don't keep the sponsors happy, that's really your problem. That's not my problem. I write my own show. And you know, we treat God like this. And search your heart for when you're doing that. When you're writing a life that God fits into, when really it's your life that fits in to him. When Joseph and Mary, they go to Bethlehem, you know, they didn't know how God would enter the world. Mary heard from Gabriel. Joseph, he heard from an angel. But they didn't know how this would all work out. And they're traveling some maybe 3 days, and Joseph has a pregnant wife. They don't know if this baby's going to be born on the way, if the baby's going to be born there, maybe after the registration. They don't know. But it's okay. And it's okay for this reason. Because the show's not all about Joseph and Mary. The show's all about God and his plan. And his plan is not afraid to use the ordinary means of having to travel to Bethlehem to get dirty and tired and move slowly and not know what's there. God still comes. Why? He's the screenplay writer. And the first application is examine your heart and catch yourself as you try and write God into your plan. And really what I'm saying is catch yourself when you tame God so that he no longer has the power to surprise. Catch yourself. Joseph and Mary had no idea how this was going to unfold. And if they listed the pros and the cons on a sheet of paper, it seemed like there'd be a whole lot more cons than pros. I mean, we got to go to Bethlehem now? Why? So this guy can assert his ownership over us? I don't even know people in Bethlehem. And now we're going to have to count on the cultural mores in which we live for people to rise to the surface and care for us in our time of need? There's more cons than pros on Joseph and Mary's list. Catch yourself when you're trying to write God into your story when you're a part of his. Jesus is a surprise in every way. Yes, there's Old Testament passages that anticipate Jesus, but to Joseph and Mary, in this passage, he's a huge surprise. And he just comes in time and space in a broken world with bad leaders, and he comes anyway. The second application is this. Expect God to be unstoppable in both an unconverted life and a converted life. So I don't know where your hearts are. I knew that there would be visitors with us. But maybe there are regulars here at King's Cross that are still a bit on the fence about Jesus. They're unsure. But this application is to expect God to be unstoppable, even if you're on the fence about Jesus, even if you're not ready to believe in Jesus. Your thoughts about Jesus, the fact that you're here this morning, that means something. Because this God, he's absolutely unstoppable. And he doesn't mind having to work through the ordinary circumstances of your life. Like your doubts, like your skepticism, like your hatred. Like the fact that you got a raw deal in your childhood and you will never believe a God that allowed that to happen. God is unstoppable. He's not afraid to enter even that circumstance. I think that's a relevant application for those who are here who may be on the fence about Jesus. But I want to speak to brothers and sisters, those who are followers of Jesus. You too need to know that God, he is unstoppable even in your converted life. Are you here this morning and you feel just too filthy to be loved by God? You know you've not given him what he deserves. You know that. You feel that? You sense that? Do you feel as though the sin that you committed just a couple of days ago, or last night, or this morning, might be the sin that breaks the camel's back? And he's going to be done with you, and he's going to turn and walk. You ever felt that? Do you feel that now? If you're not converted, God is unstoppable in your unconverted life. But brothers and sisters, he's also unstoppable in your converted life. Sanctification is bumpy business. And the realization of our sins, sometimes that in and of itself is shocking even to us. But he's unstoppable. Not only did he come to Joseph and Mary, complete nobodies, even amidst the myriad of complexities in their political and in their social world, he comes to us even in our sin. And the Bible tells us that what he began, he'll bring to completion. And I'm here to remind you, brothers and sisters, he'll never give up on you. You may not feel that even this morning. You may not believe that even this morning. Christian, he'll never give up on you. He's surprising. And ordinary circumstances don't disrupt him at all. He still comes. Jesus has come, and Jesus will come again. Welcome this morning to the fourth Sunday in Advent. Would you join me in prayer? Our Holy Father, we thank you that you are willing to work through ordinary circumstances, difficult, painful, hurtful circumstances. You're willing to work through mud and mire, and filth, and sin, and pollution. Thank you. Thank you for coming in Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.